Zachariah. This is the Ogichta drum. That's a young Ogichta, so he's mentoring these young drummers. Ogichta is a warrior, is that right? Warrior drum. It's a grandfather drum that you see here, and we use it usually ceremonially and to honor. So our drummers are Alan Zachariah, who's Mohawk, Jay Rez, Ojibwe, Isa Mc... Huh? Isaiah McFarlane, also Ojibwe, James Mixamong, he's Potawatomi, Sage Pickety, who you probably know from the O-Town Boys, he's Ojikri, and that is our drum. We're going to give him a hand. We like to open with a welcome to the Algonquin Territory, and Kleda Kamanda, who would typically do this with us, was not able to make it today, so we assigned this job to the very well-spoken and kind Tori Kress. Tori?
Annie, bonjour. Ngonzakwe Dishnakash. I'm Tori Kress. I'm with the I Don't Know More Ontario movement, and I'd like to take a minute to acknowledge the unceded Algonquin territory that we are now on. This building sits on. All these buildings sit on, and I'd like to thank Claudette for letting me to take this time to acknowledge the Algonquin territory we're all here protesting on, fighting for our right. I don't know if you guys know, but First Nations people are already under CSIS radar. We've been, I don't know if any of you have attended our I Don't Know More Be Die-In, but that was a threat to national security, it turns out. Dying on the steps of Parliament Hill dressed up as a bee is a real big threat to national security. So we're already very well aware of the lack of oversight that's happening with First Nations people, with CSIS, and it's already happening to Muslims, and a lot of brown people are suffering because of no oversight and CSIS doing what they will with information. Aboriginal Affairs is handing our information over freely to police bodies, so it's going to be happening to more Canadians. And so that's why we're here today, to rally together under the one banner of all of us, First Nations and Canadians together, trying to make a difference in the world and trying to make a difference for our right to peaceful assembly like we're doing here today, and our right to speak out against the government. So we don't want to be silenced, and they need to answer to us, because that's what they do. They answer to us, apparently. So welcome to unceded Algonquin territory. On behalf of I Don't Know More Ontario, I'd like to thank you all for joining us today. Thank you, Miigwech.
Thanks, Tor. So I'm going to bounce the water teaching that involves audience participation. We may do it afterwards if people are interested, but I want to get onto the program because there are so many things going on today, and a lot of the speakers have come and need to go to their next thing, including the play, which is quite a ways down the program. So first off, we have the grandfather drum. They will do an honor song for this. I guess everybody's already standing, but typically you would stand up to show honor. Oh, all right, where is the drum? Hey guys, honor song, please.
We're standing.
They're all there standing. No, you're drumming. We're standing. While they're getting ready, I'd like to tell you a few of the people who are going to be here today is Paul Dewar. I don't know if you guys have seen the schedule that we posted. We have Leah Gazan-Wood from, she's Mountain Lakota Nation, Treaty 4 Saskatchewan, and Yavar Hamid from Hamid Farouk said, somebody you'd like to have with you if you ever do get in trouble with CSIS. Okay, looks like we're good to go. Okay, Miigwech.
Thank you.
How appropriate that the flag should arrive at this moment and come up with the honor song. That wasn't me. Okay, it was me, but I didn't mean to.
Hello.
Okay, so we're going to ask our first speaker to come up, and we'll put in the traveling song in a few speakers from now. So, drummers, Miigwech, and you may take a break for a moment. I'm asking Paul Dewar, our MP for the NDP in this area. This is actually his little territory at the moment. And hi, Paul.
Thank you so much, Miigwech. Thank you to our drummers and, of course, to our First Nations peoples who allow us to be here today and tenders of our land for so long. First message today, to thank all of you as citizens for standing up against a wrong-headed government, against a law that is trying to interfere with our rights. So first message to all of you whose voices have been raised, thank you. Because Canadians now know what this government is attempting to do. It's attempting to use the premise of a threat to take away our rights. And there's a long history in our country where people have stood up when governments have tried to take away rights, or when people have risen up to make sure rights are gained. I think of just back not too long ago, 100 years ago, when women were fighting for the right for franchise, or First Nations were fighting for the right to franchise. They weren't given the vote. They had to fight for it. And I'll be damned if anyone is going to take away the rights we've fought for under the premise of security. Because, my friends, a free country is a safe country, and a safe country is a free country, and we have to protect our liberties. And don't buy into this false argument that we have to balance security and rights. That is not the equation. The equation is making sure we have our liberties, that we protect our liberties, because that's what makes us different from others. Now let's talk about what's in this bill. This bill will give CSIS further powers. And if the irony here is, if we recall why CSIS was created, it was because the RCMP was overstepping its boundaries. And so we created two different agencies, or we create a new agency to give CSIS its oversight to do some things that were at the time required. But we did not ever contemplate to give CSIS the ability to do what this government wants to do. And so that's why we oppose it. We oppose it because it's going to interfere with civil liberties of Canadians.
In Indian country, no. I swear that's not me. Okay, Leah.
Buju, Heyushka Washdewi, Makwa Dodem, Wood Mountain Lakota Nation, Treaty 4 Territory. And I just want to start out by saying it's a real honor to be standing on unceded Algonquin territory, to stand here in solidarity to fight a bill that will further infringe on the rights of Indigenous people in this country, to sound our voices, to protect our lands, and to protect our women around that pipeline where our women are getting attacked in the man camp. So I say Miigwech to everybody today standing here on a very brisk cold day. I just also want to say thank you to the drum and the honor songs that were sung today. I was asked to, I'm actually here just on the fly, and I didn't know I'd be speaking today, but I got a note from Linda and she asked me to come and speak. And so I said yes, because I have serious concerns about Bill C-51. And it's not that Indigenous rights, in terms of our ability to sound our voices, have not been infringed upon prior to this bill. But this bill is another attack on Indigenous people's ability to protect our lands, especially those grassroots members that stand against the pipeline on our lands, defending our lands. We see examples in Canada recently, in places like Elsipuktuk, where our grandmothers stood in solidarity defending our lands, where they were brutally attacked by the RCMP. We are not safe in this country when the very systems that are there to protect us, we now have to fear even further than we did in the past. So I say thank you to everybody for coming out here. And I say now is the time to stand in solidarity. We need to get away from us and them. We have to join together as all people that are standing on these lands to tell the government and send a clear message to the government that we will not stop. And no matter what bill they send, we will not silence our voices. We will continue to speak up. We will continue to fight for our lands. I say with that, Padamala.
She's so awesome too. I'm worried. Anybody who looks like her cannot be warm. Okay, so next up. I think we're getting caught up too. Yay, I like getting caught up. Okay, so Yavir Hamid, this is the gentleman that if something goes wrong with CSIS, you definitely want to know him. Yavir is from, Hamid Farak Zad, which is a law firm in Ottawa, right? Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Miigwech, bonjour, good afternoon. Very privileged here to be on unceded Algonquin territory to stand in solidarity with the Indigenous First Nations people and the movement of Idle No More. We are living a time in a culture of fear, fear that's being bred by unnecessary and tyrannical legislation. That fear is instilling or attempting to instill in people a chilling effect. So we don't assemble here. So we don't voice our protest. So we don't stand up for our rights. So I want to applaud everyone here for doing just that. Despite this bill, despite the provisions of expanding CSIS power, people gathering here on the streets to show their voice, to show their protest, is exactly what this government does not want. By putting us on lists, by expanding the powers to surveil, the idea is to curtail dissent. In a free and democratic society where we believe in fighting against oppression, we believe in equality, we believe in human rights, we need to protest. We need to stand up in solidarity with those who are oppressed and for those in positions in privilege. It is all the more important. Now, as Paul Dewar mentioned, there are minute changes being proposed to this bill. This is simply window dressing. The essence of this bill is really to kill dissent, to curtail our ability to speak out. And I think that this movement is only growing. It will not die, it will not be curtailed, and we will continue to fight this bill. We will continue to fight the expansion of CSIS powers and this breeding of a culture of fear, Fear Inc., as it's called, that this government, in these committee meetings, is stacking day on day, is stacking the deck with people who will breed this culture of fear, fear-mongering, to tell us that we need expanded powers, we need more lists, we need no fly lists, we need to find ways to curtail dissent and enhance security. But ladies and gentlemen, this bill will do nothing to respond to those areas, those key areas of infrastructure, security, and concern that would have prevented the devastating attacks that occurred in October of last year. It is an unnecessary bill, and what's more, it cuts at the core of human rights and values in this country that we must so dearly stand up to protect. So again, my tremendous privilege to stand here with all of you and these excellent speakers today and continue to fight C-51. Thank you.
Thank Thank you so much. And by the way, he teaches at Carleton. I think it's called State something and Descent, right? That, for the program. So you should go take State Security and Descent. So you should go take that course. Also, so next up, we have the Secretary General for Amnesty International in Canada here, Alex Neve. And they've been leading the charge on this bill. No further ado, Alex.
Thanks very much, Linda, and good morning, everyone. What an honor to be here on unceded Algonquin territory. Not only an honor, but how fitting that we gather here on Algonquin territory to speak up about rights. Our rights, the rights of Indigenous peoples, everyone's rights. Because that is what is at stake in this debate, and it is so powerful and important that we gather as we are today to continue to push that message and make sure we're doing everything we can to bring that to the attention of the government. We gather because we want to be safe. Of course we do. We want to be secure. Of course we do. We want to prevent terrorist threats. Of course we do. We want to ensure that individuals who carry out terrorist activities, just like any other criminal activity, are held to account, are brought to justice. We want all of those things. But we are gathering here because we also want, with absolute certainty and strength, human rights to be protected. And that is so much in peril as we move through this debate about Bill C-51. And in particular, we are here because we reject the notion that somehow our security is best protected by giving up a little bit on human rights. That somehow if we want to be safe, we have to accept a world in which we have fewer rights, or where the rights of some people matter less than the rights of others. We reject that notion, friends, because we know that it's exactly the opposite. We will not have a world that is safe, a world that is secure, unless and until we finally embrace human rights like we have never done before. And that means embracing all of our rights, every single person, every community. And haven't we learned that lesson? We've had so many hard, difficult, dark years since September the 11th. To learn that lesson. And sometimes it feels like we have been learning the lesson. We've had judicial inquiries here in Canada that have shown us the terrible human rights consequence of national security gone wrong. Meher Arar, Abdullah al-Malki, Ahmed al-Mati, Mouyed Nuruddin. We've had the Supreme Court of Canada, no less than the Supreme Court of Canada, underscore that in the Omar Khadr case, in the immigration security certificate ruling back in 2007. They've said human rights are imperiled and cannot be made vulnerable just because of national security. South of the border even, the lesson seems to sometimes be learned. President Obama, although he can't deliver the goods, he's sure that he needs to close down Guantanamo Bay because he knows what's at stake. We had the Senate committee report on torture in the CIA last year, and that revealed so much. There are so many lessons that have been learned. And here we have C-51. Does C-51 give us any inkling that those lessons have been learned, that those lessons matter? Instead, what do we see? We see a piece of legislation that says it is now okay for CSIS operatives to violate the Charter of Rights. It's okay. We see a piece of legislation that says it's okay for federal court judges, the guardians of the Constitution in this country, to authorize those charter violations in secretive hearings. We have a piece of legislation that imperils rights to protest by conflating protest and demonstrations with terrorism and security threats, putting at risk the fundamental rights to protest of Indigenous peoples, of environmentalists, of the labor movement, of all of us. We have a piece of legislation that, in a vague, undefined way, now says it will be criminal to promote terrorism in general. What does that mean, in general? And can you imagine the ways that is going to chill debate and discussion in this country? Because everyone will always be fearful. In general, better not say it. CSIS might be watching. Information sharing expanded beyond belief. Information about all of us shared widely across government with very few safeguards in place, as if we haven't learned any of those lessons from the past, from Meher Arar's case and all of the other cases, about the ways in which reckless, inflammatory, inaccurate information sharing isn't just a bad thing, it causes human rights violations like torture. We need to be worried about that. And we do not have a shred of improvement when it comes to review and oversight. So it does not exactly add up to a bill that gives us any confidence that those lessons have been learned, does it, friends? Quite the contrary, we are going in exactly the opposite direction. When we need legislation and policies, and above all, political leadership that puts human rights first, that recognizes our safety and our security, relies upon protecting all of our rights, we are seeing legislation, we are seeing rhetoric, we are seeing political leadership that goes exactly the opposite direction, and we will not stand for that. We cannot stand for that. It has been so powerful, important, and inspiring to see Canadians come together across the country over the last several weeks in gatherings like this, signing petitions, writing letters, and we are making a difference. The opinion polls are shifting. Canadians who at the beginning said, sure, of course, I want legislation that'll prevent terrorism, now recognize, oh, but I do not want that at the cost of my rights, your rights, our rights. I want to prevent terrorism in ways that put human rights first. And we're seeing those numbers shift. We're seeing the government feel the pressure to a certain degree. We've heard references to the fact that we now know that there's going to be a little bit of tweaking that the government's going to come forward with. Well, we know that this isn't about tweaking, friends. We know that this legislation is so flawed, is so problematic. I can tell you that on every single page of Bill C-51, there's something that violates, undermines, attacks, or affronts human rights. We don't solve that by a little tweak here, by removing a word here. So our demand has to be the same, friends. Bill C-51 has to go. That's the bottom line. There's no other way to fix it. Keep speaking out. Keep signing petitions. Keep showing out. We don't have a lot of time left, but we absolutely have to keep up with this important struggle. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Alex. That's fantastic. Okay, so we have this play that's going to go on. It is exactly 5 minutes. Don't anybody leave. We have other speakers who are coming with some very interesting points of view on this bill, on the legislation, on our freedoms. I'm just giving these guys some time to set up. They are the Quaker Theatre team, and the play is on C-51. It is called Three Traitors.
Okay. You know, I hate to disagree with the previous speaker. I don't know where he's getting off with that. We're here to celebrate C-51. We're going to show you how it's going to make us all safe. Think about it. It's going to be so much better for all of us. We won't have to worry anymore. Okay. Watch and learn. The court is now in session. His Honorable Judge Autopilot presiding.
Bring in the accused.
Do I know you?
State your names and occupations.
I am Jesse Nazareth, carpenter, and more recently, public speaker.
Next.
And I'm Buffy St. Marie, singer, songwriter, pacifist, social activist.
And you?
I'm Leonard Cohen. I think you know my name. When words are held in prison, you're the jailer. That's your game.
That's enough. Let's hear from the witness, Snark the Snitch.
Nazareth here.
has sent his gang of 12 out to infiltrate every major city and spread their dangerous ideology.
What did he tell them?
These are his exact words. If you think I come to bring peace to the earth, you are wrong. I come not to bring peace, but the sword.
You, sir, are sowing the seeds of revolution. And that's the crime of promoting terrorism in general under Bill C-51. What do you have on the other two witnesses, Snitch?
Well, the FBI has 2 tons of evidence on Buffy St. Marie, and President Lyndon Johnson himself congratulated radio stations on banning her music, including Universal Soldier. And as for Cohen, well, listen to these lyrics. Guided by a signal from the heavens, guided by a birthmark on my skin, guided by the beauty of our weapons, first we take Manhattan, then we take Berlin.
That's enough. You have all demonstrated traits of subversion and revolution. Okay, bring in Chief Barnburner, please.
Take the stand, Arnold Barnburner.
Yeah. What is it?
What do you have on the in the queues? Why weren't you able to stop them before now?
I tried to stop them. We went to some of Nazareth's dues. We tried to start a few punch-ups. No one would fight back. Bunch of weirdo non-violence, I don't know. And then Buffy St. Marie, she's hiding out in the reservation with her friend. And then she moves to Hawaii. Well, Cohen, he's up and down, gone here and there like a rabbit in a hat. That's why we got him. But now we've got him.
Okay, we have them. And you are all guilty under Bill C-51.
And if we have our way, you'll never walk out of prison alive, because we're going to put you in under the life means life rule.
Because I say so.
You are the state. Say ta, say twa, when C-51 is law, you can stick it in your craw. Ha! What's... Banner, what's happening? Order in the court! You can't do this! Help! It's a social revolution! Help!
You have succeeded. We are defeated.
Yeah. Good job. That was awesome, you guys. Regret. Okay, so now we have Mr. Daibo, all dressed in black. If you know Russ, you know he knows so much about First Nations issues, law, environment, this bill, just about everything. One of my favorite people in the world, from Defenders of the Land, Russ Daibo.
Thank you, thank you. I'm so glad to be here to speak against this bill. The other speakers, I think, have laid out the concerns pretty well, but from my perspective, as an Indigenous person, a member of the Mohawk Nation, to me, this is just another challenge we're going to have to face, because we've gone through centuries of Canada being a racist colonial state for us. You know, the situation we have is in 1982, Pierre Trudeau brought back a new constitution. I hear, you know, the speaker's talking about the charter rights, the threats that this bill will have on the charter. But there's also part two of the Constitution, Section 35, which is supposed to recognize and affirm our Aboriginal treaty rights. Well, in the 1980s, there were constitutional talks with the premiers and the prime ministers of the day, and those talks were supposed to identify what Aboriginal treaty rights were going to be protected in the Constitution. Those talks ended in failure in 1987. And then the court started to impose a legal interpretation of Section 35 to contain our rights. And since the 1990 Sparrow decision, right through to the recent Chilcotin and Grassy Narrows decisions, the Supreme Court has been out to try and limit what our rights would be within Canada. And then along with that, Canada has introduced unilateral policies to negotiate self-government and land claims. Those policies are designed to extinguish Aboriginal title, to ignore treaty rights, and to convert First Nations into municipalities. Anybody that takes a critical look at these policies, you'll see that those are the objectives of the state. Canada is a settler state, and it hasn't matured to the point where it's prepared to reconcile with Indigenous peoples. It wants to basically turn us from being peoples into ethnic minorities. And this bill, C-51, make no mistake, it's going to pass. He's got a majority in the House. He's got a majority in the Senate. Even if he makes some cosmetic amendments, it's going to pass. And the Liberal Party, you know, they have a long record of terminating Aboriginal treaty rights as well. It was the Liberal Party that introduced the 1969 White Paper. And that White Paper proposed amending the Constitution to remove any reference to Indians and lands reserved for Indians. They wanted to repeal the Indian Act, get rid of reserves, get rid of the treaties. They had a number of measures in there, which basically amounts to a termination plan. That plan is being implemented today and accelerated by the Harper government. And this bill is meant to accelerate that because it does have to do with corporate resource wars that are coming upon us for not only pipelines, but for hydro, mining, all of our lands and resources. They aren't interested. They're using the term reconciliation, but that means surrender to state sovereignty, territorial integrity of Canada, the security, the economy. And we have pre-existing sovereign rights. We're the only groups in Canada that do. And this bill is going to basically put us into a major conflict with the Canadian state. And I don't see the Liberals, if they form the government, doing anything to change that, given their attitude about this bill right now and their record on trying to terminate Aboriginal treaty rights. So we're going to need the support of other Canadians if we really want Canada to mature as a state, as a country, as a society, and if we really want reconciliation where we have to fight or surrender as Indigenous peoples and as Canadians.
Fight!
We're fighting!
Fight.
We're fighting!
That's good. I'm ready to fight too.
Yeah!
So let's do it. Thank you.
That was the shortest time I've ever seen Russ Diabo speak. He must be cold. Thank you so much, Russ. So, next up. Wow, I'm so surprised. Okay. Farouki. Now, Farouk is on the Council of Canadian Women. She is a physician. The Council of Canadian Women's been around for, I think, over 30 years. They are handling a number of issues. I think a lot of the people here will be familiar with what's going on. And I'm going to introduce her right now. She's right here. Are you ready? Okay, thanks so much. Farouk.
Thank you so much. First of all, I want to thank all of you for coming out this morning. It's a cold day, but you know what? The sun is shining, spring is coming, and I feel very hopeful. And the reason I feel so hopeful is because of people like you. And people like the organizers of this very peaceful protest. So I want to say to everyone, Salaam Alaikum. Salaam means peace. So I wish peace to everyone here, to all of my fellow Canadians, and to Prime Minister Harper, and to our government. I want to thank Idle No More Ontario and LEAD Now for organizing this peaceful protest against a bill that is ill-conceived, flawed, and very ill-considered. I recognize that I stand on unceded Algonquin territory as we protest this bill, which has the potential to criminalize the legitimate descent of concerned citizens of many different backgrounds. And while I was listening to the other speakers, some thoughts were going through my mind. There's so many examples before us of very famous people who have been dissidents, who have dissented against the laws that existed during their time. Who remembers Nelson Mandela? Nelson Mandela was criminalized. He was thrown in jail for decades. Finally, he was released, and his own country, South Africa, and many other countries, including our own, recognize him for being a hero, because he is a hero. And what are heroes? Heroes are people like you, me, all of the people who fight against the erosion of human rights and fight for human dignity. That's what a hero is. The Indigenous peoples of Canada, for whom successive governments have yet to make any meaningful reparations for the seizure of their lands and resources, are being targeted yet again. And, you know, it really makes me think. I came here as an immigrant when I was 4 years old. And I grew up in this country, and I love this country. This country gave me so many opportunities, opportunities that have been denied to my Indigenous brothers and sisters. We should take a moment and think about the fundamental injustice in what I just said. But nobody talks about it. Environmentalists, minority groups, civil libertarians, and ordinary citizens like you and me need to be able to speak freely in the cause of justice, just as we're doing today. I'm a Canadian Muslim woman, and I'm fiercely loyal to our Constitution. I welcome the opportunity to stand on the grounds of Canada's Parliament to ask all of my fellow citizens to consider the implications of this bill. Along with everyone else in Canada, I mourn, along with the families of the slain officers who were murdered back in the fall. But my plea is especially directed to Prime Minister Harper and to our elected MPs. I plead with them to listen to the concerns of the electorate. Yes, we have problems. We need to tackle the problem of radicalized Muslim youth in Canada. But Bill C-51 is not the way to do this. The best approach is to work at all levels of society to ensure that these misguided individuals who are alienated and deeply confused have a place at the table and feel that they're a part of mainstream society with all of its resources and opportunities. We have examples before us in other countries where countries have gone the opposite route and they've reaped what they've sown. We don't want to import the ways in which successive European generations have left disaffected youth to smolder with resentment in the banlieues. We don't want that in Canada. As you all know, Bill C-51 was debated for only 3 days in the House of Commons before it passed second reading and went to committee. And at committee, so many needed voices that needed to be heard were not heard. Voices like those of Privacy Commissioner Daniel Tarien, who's an officer of Parliament. The voices of four former Prime Ministers of Canada, John Turner, Jean Chrétien, Paul Martin, and Joe Clark. And now committee hearings are closed, and the government is set to examine, clause by clause, this proposed omnibus legislation before it goes to third reading. It's true that yesterday the government announced some modest amendments that it's prepared to make. But those amendments do not address the main flaws of the bill. As you all know, there's been a groundswell of objection to this bill by legal scholars, such as Kent Roach of the University of Toronto and Craig Forsesi of Ottawa U. They have analyzed this bill, gone through it, clause by clause, by word, and found so many troubling aspects of it. Some of those aspects which are particularly troubling are those aimed at terrorist propaganda, which they found to be too broad and too vague and could criminalize you, me, and anyone who dares to utter any sort of meaningful dissent. The main flaw, of course, is lack of oversight of the sweeping new powers that are afforded to CSIS under this bill. We need to remember that CSIS was created by an act of parliament in 1984. Why? Because the Macdonald Commission advised Parliament to disband the disgraced RCMP Security Service. It was clear at that time, and it should be clear to us today, that intelligence gathering by a spy agency should be distinct from law enforcement to prevent the abuse of power. At the same time, the officer of the Inspector General was created, along with the Security Intelligence Review Committee, to create some checks on those powers. But what happened? The Inspector General's office was scrapped by the government in 2012 for lack of funding. And CIRC is by no means an oversight committee, nor was it ever intended to be. It's a review committee meant to review after the fact the activities of CSIS. The government has conflated oversight with review, and the two are very distinct and should not be confused. Oversight means ongoing and direct vetting of decision-making that's made by CSIS during its operations. CIRC is not an oversight committee. And in fact, it's been understaffed. It has only 4 part-time members. A 5th position is still unfilled. There's no mention of CIRC made in Bill C-51. And as others before me have mentioned, things go wrong, and things have gone wrong. The federal government was forced to apologize to Maher Arar and to compensate him for his unlawful seizure and detention in Syria. So we have reason to be afraid. So what are we left with? We're left with a wide-reaching omnibus piece of legislation that's been hastily drawn up, that was given only 3 days of debate in the House of Commons, and only select people were invited to committee meetings, which are now closed. So many people have raised their voice in opposition to this bill. People who are wiser than I am. People like Ed Broadbent. People like Alex Neve of Amnesty International. Paul Dewar. The Canadian Bar Association. Even the formal CSIS Chief of Intelligence have raised grave objections to the way that this bill has been proposed. At the Canadian Council of Muslim Women, we are loyal to our charter. We're loyal Canadians, and we're deeply concerned for our country. We ask our government to pause and think before we create a worsened security situation. My plea is to the government of Canada, please work with us and all other groups in a nonpartisan way so that we can ensure the security and civil liberties of all Canadians. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Miigwech. I'd like to announce our next speaker. This is Sean McKenney. He's with the Ottawa and District Labour Council. I don't know where Ontario has been working very closely. Sean's been one of our greatest supporters and an ally. So I'd like to introduce him and welcome him to come speak on unceded Algonquin territory. Miigwech.
Thank you. In communities, towns, cities, provinces across this country, people are coming together, like we are today, to denounce C-51, to denounce the erosion of our rights yes. and our freedoms that C-51 will surely cause. Unquestionably, the security and safety of our nation is paramount to all Canadians, but all Canadians must continue to have the right to assemble, to rally, to protest, to come together. Yeah. As people, we must never be made afraid through law or other means to speak out against others, against corporations or organizations, and most importantly, against government and those who make laws. That voice can never and must never be allowed to be silenced. Our civil liberties and democratic freedoms we have today, we have because we did everything. We did everything over the last 100-plus years. The bill C-51 threatens. We won't be allowed to do tomorrow. I've been involved in hundreds, perhaps thousands of demonstrations, rallies, picket lines, assemblies over the last 20 years in this city. It's because of those activities and actions that we have made some change, good change. Positive change. I shudder to think what our country would resemble today if not for people coming together with many voices, yet delivering one message over the last 100-plus years. stable fixtures in labor history, such as the Winnipeg General Strike in 1919, on to Ottawa Track in the 1930s, coal miners in Nova Scotia in the early 1900s, asbestos workers in Quebec in the late 1940s, the Ford Strike in 1945, or Labor Day, or May Day, and the list goes on, but a list that Bill C-51 would show individuals and their activities defined and etched through history, all similar, and their gains, like labor gains, would not be if C-51 and what it entails existed then. A person's name or color of their skin or voicing through social media their displeasure of government does not and must not ever mechanically brand someone a terrorist. Our coming together today is not a terrorist threat, but the coming together of many. The many who bring a message in denouncing this anti-democracy, this anti-civil liberties bill. The 1930s, R.B. Bennett, the conservative prime minister at the time, stated that the On to Ottawa trek was, and I quote, not a mere uprising against law and order, but a definite revolutionary effort on the part of a group of men to usurp authority and to destroy government. R.B. Bennett's government went from 139 seats to just 39 in the 1935 election as a direct result of his suggesting that by today's definitions and C-51, all of those folks were terrorists. What we all need to do today is to ensure that tomorrow and in the coming months, Stephen Harper's conservatives and the seats they hold governing our country are significantly reduced as well. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Sean. I wanted to say, just by the way, if you're wondering why there's a zillion RCMP vehicles there, they're actually here to say hi to me because they heard I was here. No, really, they're not here because of you guys. They actually loaned us our coolers because I goofed and didn't provide the proper seating for the drum. We have a good relationship with our police here, so, you know, be cool to them. They're not doing anything wrong to us. So we have Sophie coming up next, but in the meantime, the drummers look like they're ready to do a quick song for us, so feel free to move about and warm up a little tiny bit, and Sophie will be right with us after that. McGuetch, go ahead. Ogichta. Wichita. Okay, everybody come back. We are going to do a really big round dance at the end. Our next speaker is Sophie Harkat. Sophie's husband, Mohammed Harkat, has been in the news a lot. She's been doing a lot of work dealing with his in-house arrest, and he's followed around with two armed guards when he leaves his home, and he's not allowed to be alone in his home. There's all kinds of crazy things going on in their lives. She'll give you some more information. Please come on up, Sophie. Thank you so much for coming.
Hi, everyone. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to share the injustice as my family has been living the past 12 years. Also, that security certificate's under a review under Bill C-51. And I'm also touched and very honored to have been invited by the Idle No More Ontario. So thank you for that. For the past 12 years, I've been fighting for my husband, not only because I believe in his innocence, but because I believe in due process and transparency and accountability. For all these years, we've been asking for a fair and open trial so he can defend himself. It is important not only for my husband, but for all Canadians to know the case against him. We have never been afraid of the truth. His life and her family's have been ruined by allegations. Why is CSIS refusing to put it out there? Why is CSIS overusing the term national security? We need to question everything. A security certificate is like being accused of murder, except you don't know who you killed, when it happened, and where and how you did it, and you're asked to defend yourself. Our nightmare began 12 years ago on December 10th, International Human Rights Day, when my husband was arrested and thrown in jail. He was never charged, never given the evidence. Deemed a threat to national security, he was taken away from our family, and we were never given the reasons why. His public counsels kept in the dark. Here's what an allegation report looks like. Every sentence starts with, "We assume, we believe, we allege that in the past, present, or future, this person may be involved in acts of terrorism or part of a network." That could be anyone at any time. That's why we need to question and we need to have serious concerns against Bill C-51. We are setting dangerous precedents, and my family has been living it. My husband, he spent 43 months in jail, and when he was finally released on bail, I became a full-time jailer and a prisoner in my home for 3.5 years. Imagine a life where you wear a GPS around your ankle 24/7 for 7.5 years, and you plug yourself into a wall for 2 hours to recharge a GPS. Imagine having to watch your husband because he can never be left alone in the house or in the backyard. He needs supervision around the clock. Even in his own home. Imagine having two surveillance cameras in your home, mail intercepted, all visitors pre-approved by the Canadian Border Service Agency, including my newborn nephew and my 80-year-old grandmother. Imagine someone listening to all your calls, including your solicitor client calls. Imagine 3 outings a week for 4 hours each, approved 48 to 96 hours in advance, including all locations you visit and every person you meet. Imagine being followed by 2 to 6 CBSA officers all the time, wearing bulletproof vests, carrying weapons, driving police-style vehicles parked in front of your home during a Christmas dinner. Imagine having to share a public washroom or a doctor appointment because my husband can never be left alone. Imagine going to a movie or an event surrounded by officers. Imagine the constant sound of a walkie-talkie following you. Imagine having no more personal space. Imagine getting your house raided by 16 officers and 3 sniffing dogs. Imagine being followed at the grocery, the restaurant, or while on the public bus. Imagine being followed to your grandfather's funeral. Imagine what goes on behind closed doors that we don't get to see or that we don't get to hear. I'm a Canadian and my rights were violated. It happened to my husband, it happened to me, it happened to my family, it happened to everyone that loved Mo, and it could happen to you. Imagine, just imagine, it's happening right here in Canada. For 12 years, we've been dehumanized, humiliated, put into question, even under oath. You testify, you're a liar. You don't testify, you're hiding someone. You're hiding something. Every word, every moment, every breath put into question. Not only my husband, but myself, my family, and our friends.
every aspect of our private lives exposed and scrutinized. Winter protests are much harder with gloves on. I fear for the future where we are allowed to arrest and detain more individuals based on allegations, association, uncontested hearsay. I worry about someone's life being ruined by an informant whose credibility can never be tested in secret proceedings. I worry about a court that continues to base their decision on the lowest standard of proof or on reasonable grounds to believe that someone could be a threat. I urge our members of parliament, decision makers, courts, to put an end to secret trials, two-tier justice system, and to stop Bill C-51. Those laws have no place in the Canadian democracy. We've been warning Canadians that this would happen. Watch out, because you could be next. I would like to end on a quote by my good friend Matthew Behrens. Let's all become terrorists of love and peace. Let's become terrorists of freedom, democracy, and justice. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Almost tricked her. I like to do that to Tori once in a while, just not show up. Okay, so next up we have Dan Parlow. Now Dan, and he's here to talk about that. Dan Parlow.
It's cold out here, eh? Not as cold as your heart, so. So anyways, as mentioned, my name is Dan Parlow, and miigwech to the drummers, miigwech to the flag bearers, miigwech to yous that are out here today braving this cold to speak out against this bill. As mentioned, I've spent over 30 years, almost 30 years of my life incarcerated in penitentiaries across Ontario, in the Kingston area, and provincial jails. Anyways, I'm here to talk to you about... I have actually a little fact sheet that I think is important for you to hear, and I'm going to speak from my heart, because that's what matters. Okay. So anyways, here's some facts about our people who are incarcerated. First, let me say, I know something about oppression. I'm an Indigenous man. I'm a survivor of colonization. I'm a survivor of the 60s scoop, and I'm a survivor of historic trauma, intergenerational effects, and the criminalization of my people of the state. I'm a survivor of that prison system. Today, I study criminology at Carleton University, and I'm trying to be a voice for our people, you know, and see some justice done for our people. And, you know, I want to say this, too. It's a great honor to be here in Ottawa from Batchewana, Rankin, Reference Point, Sault Ste. Marie. And the people of this community have adopted me, taken me in, shown me love and compassion. This is why I'm succeeding. It has nothing to do with corrections. It has nothing to do with their jails. Their jails do nothing for me. Okay, anyways, here's some facts. Aboriginals, we are routinely classified as higher risk and higher need in categories such as employment, community reintegration, and family support, which means longer incarceration periods. We are released later in our sentences and have lower parole rates. Most of Aboriginals leave prison at statutory release or warrant expiry dates. We are overrepresented in segregation and maximum security prisons. The use of force during times of intervention and incidents are much higher than others. Our people are more likely to return to prison for parole violations, and not for new crimes, but often administration reasons. While Aboriginal people make up 4% of the Canadian population, 23.2% of federal inmate population is Aboriginal. There are approximately 3,400 Aboriginal offenders in federal penitentiaries, approximately 71% of First Nations, 24 Métis, and 3% Inuit that are in our prisons, our federal prisons. Women are much higher rates. Bill C-51 is a direct attack on all our rights. It is intended to undermine, protest, silent dissent, and oppose those who would challenge or question the status quo of Stephen Harper's Canada. I know something about oppression, as I mentioned, and I survived all these efforts of to oppress me, but endured and healed, and I'm here to speak to you for my people. I'm speaking for the 25% of Indigenous people who are wasting away in our prisons in Canada. Yeah. I'm speaking for the hundreds of women and girls who are missing and murdered and who Stephen Harper says are not on his radar. I'm speaking for the Aboriginal children and youth who are in foster care in Canada and a higher number than attended Indian residential schools. And a result of that, many of whom grew up with little knowledge of their cultural and history. I'm speaking for my people against the continued oppression and effects to entrench it further through Bill C-51. I speak for them and you. I bring a warning. Aboriginal people understand oppression. We understand how fragile rights are and how easily the state can take rights away. Learn from us, from our history, and resist Stephen Harper's agenda to take away our rights.
Yeah.
This message is for Mr. Harper. You will not silence me. You will not with these bills you pass. I will continue to work for our people. Miigwech.
That was really great. Thanks, Dan. Ah, the grannies. Yay! Where are those grannies? I don't really know what I can say about these ones. They've been raising a lot of hell for a lot of years. Thank goodness. Here they come. All 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 grannies. This is quite the granny turnout. We are honored. Come on, grannies, come right across the front here. Raging grannies. You really gotta listen to the words of their songs. They have something to say. Who wants a mic? You want me to hold it? Raging grannies. Yeah! Woo!
We'd like to invite you to sing along if you've got copies of the words. Some of you do, I know. We listen to Parliament day after day, our hopes to see justice done dribble away. There's talk and there's drivel and groan, but when it's deciphered, damn, all has been done. First Nations people are low on that poll, which shouldn't surprise us, that's always their role. Their numbers are small and they sure are not rich, and money is power, now ain't that a bitch? Sure, First Nations people are low on their list, but now there's a movement the feds get dismissed. First Nations people are idle no more, they're taking their power that none can ignore. So, grannies sing out and we hope those guys hear, those suits who've been nattering year after year. The waiting is over, the warning is clear. Be fair to First Nations, put justice in gear. Bill C-51 will not shut us up. We're idle no more, and our struggle won't stop.
If you go onto the hill today, you're in for a big surprise. If you go onto the hill today, you'd better go in disguise. For every spy and spook in the land has all your data at their command. Whatever you do, they're labeling you a terrorist. Don't demonstrate for hiking trails, for food for children, or medical care for veterans. Don't go out to save the whales, and never ever mention climate change. Voting is the only thing a simple citizen is ever allowed to do. Just watch the world go to hell in a handcart, or you'll be clapped in jail once Bill C-51 goes through. So shut your mouth and trust in Big Brother. Don't care about a thing that Stephen Harper's advice to you.
Sorry, we had to have a hug-a-thon for all those grannies. Oh, I lost my... I have no idea what's going on next. When I do that thing? Oh, yeah. Okay, so next up we have Amy Kieschek, our co-organizer from Lead Now.
Thank you so much for inviting me here today to speak on unceded Algonquin territory. It's a real honor and a privilege. What's been wonderful about these gatherings and being able to be here with all of you is hearing the stories of struggle, the history we have in Canada, of different communities fighting for their rights, asserting those rights. It's been a pleasure for me as well and my family to be able to talk about our own history. My parents and myself emigrated to Canada from Palestine, and to be able to reflect on what it meant for my parents to live under Israeli occupation, to really feel what it means to live under a lack of freedom of expression, of freedom to exercise political, democratic, social rights. And really, it's tragic to think that they came here hoping to be able to really to speak out or to have to experience liberty in this way, to be discriminated against over and over again by a government they thought would give them refuge. So it's been an experience to reflect on that. And I think Bill C-51 stands for all of the things that are antithetical, the complete opposite of my parents' struggle, of the struggle that we've all been fighting for, and this ideal Canadian identity that we hope to one day share, but really is non-existent. It's troubling to hear that the Conservative government is still pushing this bill forward. Yes, there are amendments being proposed, but I think we need to keep fighting. And again, it's wonderful that people are out today, and I hope we keep this going. There's talks of more rallies coming up, maybe going to MPs' offices, targeting them, getting them to sway their votes, but also talking to your loved ones and talking to people in your community, making this a live issue. I know that I met a lot of wonderful young people the last few weeks at the last rally here today, who it was their first time ever coming out to a protest, a demonstration. And it's wonderful that people are finally waking up to this, and I hope that we can continue to have those discussions to shake people up. It's really going to come down to voting, and they're counting on us not to show up to the polls whenever there is whenever the election comes. So make sure that, you know, you as a young person, or your friends, your children, people in your community are out there making their voices heard. They're counting on our disempowerment. They're actively disempowering us. So it's time to reclaim our power and to reject Bill C-51. So I wonder if you guys want to do a cheer. I know everyone's like a little low energy. Do you want to cheer? Okay, so I'm going to say reject, and I want you to say fear. Got it? So reject.
Fear.
Reject.
Fear.
Reject.
Fear.
Reject.
Fear.
Kill Bill 51.
Kill Bill 51.
Kill Bill 51. Kill Bill 51. Thanks, guys.
Somebody had to do a cheer. Yay, Amy. Oh, my God, I have a phone and no... I think I know who's next, though. Do we have Larry Russo? No way. Oh, we do? Okay, I got to go back and find out.
No, it's okay. All right, come on.
From PSAC, NCR, Larry Russo. I had actually forgotten. I'm so sorry. Thank you, Larry. Okay, so the union point of view?
Ta-da. Oh, no. No, it's just Larry today. Yeah, and seeing all the grannies, you know, remember back in 2007 when the grannies got in the canoe and assaulted Montebello, the greatest security threat to the G8 conference? That was absolutely amazing. That was just great. All right, so... the grannies totally rock, and so I hope that you continue to be a real, real threat to the security of this country. Because, no, it's true, everybody's got a grandmother, okay? Including Stephen Harper, so we got to start working on her, right? There you go. Teach that boy something. So I just want to say that I am idle no more. We are idle no more. We are idle no more. We are
idle no more.
We are
idle no more.
Yes. Idle no more in denouncing the travesty that is C-51. You know, we take away people's rights and civil liberties in order to protect our rights and I don't get it. We really, really have to take this government to task on flying by the seat of their pants. They come out with C-51, which is half-baked, all right? It really is, folks, it's half-baked. No consultation. They dream this up in that office across the street there, and then they come out with it, right? The worst kind of egregious legislation you can think of, and then at the last minute they say, okay, you know what, we're gonna take the really bad parts out. We listened to you. We modified the legislation, we amended it. Well, that's bullshit, folks, and we know it. Because when you give a judge, when you ask a judge and give that judge power to violate charter rights and freedoms that make Mohawkats experience, minimizes that experience and says, that's what we're going to do. That's the bottom line now. That's the line. What happened to Mo is going to happen to anybody. And right now, it's Aboriginals, it's Muslims, and visible minorities who constitute the majority population in the detention center on Innes Road, as well as the detention center over here in Gatineau, in Baltetro. You go to the detention center right now, and what do you see? You see women who are in the waiting room waiting to go see their men in the back. It's a shame. And you say, oh my God, look at all of the women here are Aboriginal or Muslim. It's just like mind-boggling. So C-51 is all about putting more Aboriginals and Muslims and those we demonize. It will be us, absolutely. Trade unionists next, environmental terrorists next, all right? So we have to stand up to this legislation. No consultation, folks, that's the new bottom line. Don't ask, we just go ahead and do. That's called dictatorship, okay? They are really sacrificing democracy. And then they have public hearings in the House of the People, and you have people like Diana Blonsey. Last week I said it was Diane Finley, but a Blonsey Finley is all the same damn thing, okay? Who are demonizing people in the name of the people, which is a shame. It is absolutely a shame. 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 All right? So we have to really take into consideration, my friends, what Sister Amy just said. That we've got to get out there and we've got to vote these people out.